Shalom and welcome to another weekly Bible study as we continually rightly divide the word of Yahweh as a workman. Now, I'd like to welcome all those who will be viewing this video. This is actually on the Enoch calendar. I'm coming to you on the night of the 30th or already starting the 31st day. It's already sundown here, but I wanted to come to you at this time because people, there is so much about this time of season, this time of life or the time of season, past, present, and the future coming, about the Passover, the unleavened bread, and of course the first fruits. But where we sit right now, how unbelievable this is for all of you that are following the videos, you're following this on the Enoch calendar that according to the Dead Sea Scrolls that I'm following, this at sundown be the night of the last day on Enoch's calendar, which, and we're going to tomorrow is that day, the 12-hour day, the 12-hour day tonight or tomorrow as we go into Tuesday would be that 12-hour day or starting tonight. So I wanted to come to you at this time. This is a very exciting time for those that understand that actually 2 weeks from tonight about 2,000 years ago, the Messiah, according to the calendar that we follow, the Messiah would be having breaking bread and wine, not bread, and telling his apostles to drink the cup, and then he would not drink it again till he drank it new when he come into his kingdom. Of course, we'll talk about that when that night gets here, but I'm just saying we're just that close, 2 weeks from tonight. So let's kind of refresh a little bit. So we know that on the 31st day in John 11, we'll look here, where Christ raised Lazarus from the dead, was around sundown that afternoon, which is a sign to our resurrection. When Christ said in John 6, we'll see that also here in just a few minutes, that I'll raise you up at the last day. The last day, the Greek word is ekatos. We get our word eschatology. So that is a certain day. That is a singular. That is singular in the Greek. And it is pertaining to a certain day, people. So there again, when the Messiah said four times in John 6 chapter that those that do the will of the Father and believe and have eternal life, I will raise you up at the last day. That is a specific day. So it's not a day of imminency for the rapture. I mean, the Christ never said nothing. There's nothing about that. Am I getting in that? But when are we going to believe what the Messiah said, people? When are we going to believe and follow what our Master said? Because he said, if you hear my sayings and do them not, you're like a foolish man. If you hear my sayings and do them, you're like a wise man. So there again, we need to follow the Messiah. So this is such an exciting, there again, time, in the time of life, time of season. So let's take a quick look at the scripture. And let's pick it up after the feeding of the last video, the feeding of the 5,000 of the 12 baskets fulls were left over. Let's drop on down a little bit when Christ is talking about he's the bread of heaven. So let's look here in John 6:25. And he said, John 6:25, I'll raise it up here where you can see. Start 6:25. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto Rabbi, when comest thou hither? This word means, what did you come to this place for? Yeshua answered them, saying, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, that because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for the meat which endureth to everlasting or eternal life, which the Son of Man shall give unto you, for him is the Father sealed. Then said they unto him, What shall we do? What shall we do that we might work the works of God? And Christ said, answered and said to them, This is the work of God, that you believe on him who he has sent. They said therefore unto him, What oath showest thou then? What Simeon showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What does thou work? Always look for the sign here, see. Now notice what Christ said. Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, and it was written that God gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Yahshua said to them, Truly, truly, I say unto you, Moses gave you not the bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. Now notice, people, for the bread of God is he which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the cosmos. And this is why Paul calls Christ the second man from heaven. Adam was the first man from the earth. Christ was the second man, and where was he from? Right here he says, because he come from heaven. So Paul said Christ is the second man from heaven, and also he's the last Adam. A lot of people get that mixed up and say Christ is the second Adam. No, the scripture says, Paul says, he's the second man. Adam was the first. Christ was the second man, but he was not made from the dust. He come from heaven. He was incarnated, come from heaven, and Paul calls him the last Adam when he died on the tree. Okay, and giveth life unto the world. Then said they unto the Lord, Evermore give us this bread. Yeshua said to them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. See, Christ is talking to Judah here. He knows that Judah's branches are going to be broken off in 70 AD. He prophesies this all the way. This comes from the Torah people, that the house of Israel and the house of Judah be a great tumult there. And Jeremiah describes the fair olive tree and their branches is being broken off eventually. And so Christ has continued with his prophecy, but he's looking for the lost sheep of the house of Israel so he can preach to them that the kingdom of heaven is nigh. And he come not with the lost sheep, but that does not mean he only come for the law, only. He come for the lost sheep first. And I will get into more on the teaching of that. But yes, he come for the lost sheep of the house of Israel first, and then the light unto the Gentiles. Okay, I said unto you that you also have seen me and believe not. All the Father giveth me shall come to me, and in him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. Now, where do we get this? You mean the Father, he's letting them know that the Father seals them or they're born from the Father, just what he said in John 3, you got to be born again. Now he's letting them know that the Father gives those to that comes to Christ. In other words, to be taught, to be conformed to Christ's image, the body of Christ, the ecclesia he's building. Okay, verse 38, For I came down from heaven not to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. And of course, Christ teaches. He teaches people in Matthew 12, 50, that all of those that do the will of the Father is his sisters, his brothers, mothers, So Christ come down to do the will of the Father. We're birthed of the Father, given to Christ to be conformed to his image, and Christ is going to teach us as the body. The body has many members and one spirit, and he's head over it. So the beloved Son that the Father was pleased in, that's why no man can come to the Father except through the Hodos, the way, the truth, the life. For Christ is the Hodos, the way. So we are conformed to Christ, given to Christ by the Father through new birth. And then we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Savior. We follow his teachings. There again, now let's see. And this is the Father's will, which he has sent me, that of all which he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it again, resurrect at the ekatos last day. How many times is he going to say this, people? Now, the will of the Father is what? Christ come down to do the will of the Father. Let's read what is the will of the Father that Christ has to do. Let's see what he says. This is the will which Thelema, which has sent me. The Father's will that sent me. That all, pass, the whole, this is not everybody, people. This is the all, the ones believing, the ones been made alive in Christ. Okay, of all which the Father gives to Christ, he should lose that. This is the will of the Father, people. Christ come down to save all those that the Father gives him a spiritual understanding to be conformed to his image. And know that he would not lose anything, but what? When you die, you go to heaven? No, but should rise it up again at the ekatos last day. The last day on Enoch's calendar is what this is talking about. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may is not in a text, have eon life, and I will raise, here we go. How many times the Messiah has to say it? I'll raise him up at what? The ekatos, last day. Now, Paul says, in 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter, starting around verse 51. I'll show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we'll all be changed. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, twinkling means the twinkling of an eye. That's it, as the sun commences in that twinkling, twilight period, we will be changed in a moment and a twinkling of an eye at the last trump. Last means ekatos, same word is what Christ uses at the last day. So as the Son here, this is so important. Where are we? In the future coming here, people, right here is where I'm giving the video is right here at nighttime. Tomorrow will be the 12-hour day, daylight. Okay, now, right here is what Paul's talking about. We'll all be changed in a moment of twinkling of an eye. We'll be at sundown tomorrow afternoon in the future. A future coming of an end of a year. Not now, I'm just showing you, though, the pattern. So this is the time of season, time of life. Now, the two witnesses that will prophesy for 1260 days, they will die back here on 4 days prior to that, on the last Shabbat on that year, sometime during that day on the Sabbath, and then 4.5 days later, three and a half days later, they will stand up at midday and be called up to this place, which is, I believe, according to Scripture, was the Mountain of Transfiguration. Now, I believe that's Mount Hermon. Some people think it's another mountain, but I believe it's Mount Hermon. But nevertheless, it's a certain place. It's not called up to the third heaven. The Greek word means the same place when he said, some of you standing here, same place, will not taste death till you see me coming. That's the two witnesses. But where did he take them a few hours later, according to Scripture? 6 days walk, and they went up in the mount of where the vision was on the transfiguration there. So same thing's going to happen. The two witnesses are going to prophesy. They're not taste death. And after their prophecy, they're going to die. According to the Enoch calendar, they'll die on the Sabbath, the last Sabbath, 3.5 days later, right here, midday. They'll be called up, and then the mystery of the body of Christ and those that had a good report will be resurrected at sundown and will be called up in the clouds in the air to meet him. Now that will be the harpazo, rapture, people. I teach the rapture. But the rapture is not 3.5 years before or 7 years before. It is on the last day, just what Christ said. It's the last day, according to the Enoch calendar, on the time of lifetime of season, people, to start a brand new Jubilee year. I know there's lots and lots of people that preach the rapture is going to take place on the seventh month, on the Feast of Trumpets. At one time, I followed that and even thought the Day of Atonement, because the trumpet blows at the last trump on the Day of Atonement on the Jubilee year. But that's not what Christ is talking about. He's talking about the last day. That's not the last day. That's the 10th day of the seventh month. And that's not the last day on the trumpets, because the Feast of Trumpets starts on the first day of the new year. We're raised at the last day. So, and think about time of life, time of season that starts God's new season or new life or the Jubilee year when all land goes back to its rightful owner. Unbelievable. So we're sitting right here during this time. That's why I wanted to do this video, so I could get it up about this time to show us where we are sitting in Scripture and what was fulfilled. And as we follow the divine days, when Christ says in Matthew 21, I'm going to take the vineyard from you, Judah. And when he gave the parable and they told him, and he said, when they slew the son, they didn't reverence and they slew him. Then Christ said, what will the father do with these men? And their answer, the Pharisees answered out of their own mouth, he will miserably destroy those men. Now, watch now, people. And lend out the vineyard. Lend it out. That means to lease. That's not forever. But lend out the vineyard to another husbandry or another people that brings forth the fruits during their seasons. The word seasons in the Greek means the same as moedim in the Hebrew. The Greek word keras, what was used right there, is it means bring forth the fruits during the divine days, the Shabbat and the holy days. And people, when that hits and gets out there, now for you people that think that season just means the different seasons, that word is keras, and in the Septuagint it's used in Genesis 1:14. So I have traced these words all the way back in the Greek Septuagint, which is very reliable, compatible translation from the Hebrew scriptures to the Greek scriptures 160 years before the Messiah ever got here or thereabouts. Now, what are we going to do with that? Now, see, that's my message I've been putting out to the Hebrew people. Christ, that word's used 80-something times in the Renewed Covenant. Why aren't y'all teaching what the Messiah said? Now, I know you're keeping the divine days, but it's taught in the Greek New Testament. The body of Christ has to follow the Messiah on the holy days. Christ said it there in his parable, and then in verse 44, he said, I will take the kingdom from you, speaking to them, Judah, and I will give it to a nation, an ethnic nation. That is the nation Peter's talking about, a peculiar nation, a royal priesthood. And I will give it to that nation, and they will bring forth fruits during their seasons. Right now, we bring forth fruits during our seasons. And that's the holy days, people. And matter of fact, we are at the end of the fruit being brought forth until the fullness of the Gentiles come in. Okay, enough of that. So now let's go on here, and let's see. Everlasting life, I'll raise him up and get the last day. The Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which comes down from heaven. They said, is not this Yeshua the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How it is then that he saith he comes down from heaven? Now they always rebuke Christ as being illegitimate, a bastard, in their teachings, because they know that the word back then that Mary was pregnant and Joseph covered and married for. That's taught in the scriptures. So you got to understand this is what they're thinking in their mind. Yeshua therefore answered and said to them, murmur not among yourselves. Now this really does nail it down. What does he say? No man. Now when he says no man can come to me except the Father which has sent me, draw him, and I will raise him up when? At the last day. Now, when did Christ, when would, this is John 6:44. No man can come to me. Now, where did the teaching come from, people? If we're following the teaching of the Messiah, where did this come from? Well, let's just see where it come from. We got to know this, people. Right here. John. The first chapter. Right here. Let's see if we, let's just go right back to John 1. Right here. But as many as receive Christ, lambano, take a hold of, that's what it means. It means to take a hold of his teachings. To them give the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Okay, now look. What now? John continues. So as many as receive him, but those that receive him, that get the authority to become the sons of God, they are not born of the of bloods, that's actually in the plural, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Okay, so now let's go back. Now we see exactly Christ, no man, so a man cannot come to Christ unless he's born from above. You got to put the teachings together, people. You can't take it. I mean, in other words, I can't preach this private interpretation unless I've got a witness that ties to this. So we have several witnesses, but all you need is two in scripture or more. No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me, draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught of the Father. Every man therefore that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh to me. Not that many man as man has seen the Father, save he that which of God has seen the Father, that he has. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. Now, okay, now notice, we got belief, and now he says, if you believe, in which we're believers, we've been given to Christ to be conformed, now we have eonian life in us, Zoe life in us here. Okay, now notice, I am the bread of life. Your fathers did eat man in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which cometh down from heaven. A man may eat thereof and not die, because we have eternal life. I am the living bread which come down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live. This is not for ever here. The Greek text is unto the age. And the age here, people, these Greek words are left out. There's a lot of controversy. We live for, yes. But when you're asleep in Christ, at the last day, last trump, now you'll be conformed, literally, sumorphos, you will literally put on his spiritual body once that trumpet sounds, at the last day, last trump. So, and the bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the cosmos. Now, when, right here, they have no idea, he's going to give his flesh, which I will give for the Zoe life of the cosmos. What is the cosmos? This is God's orderly arrangement. For God so loved the cosmos. There is an order in his, every man in his order, talking about the resurrection of the heavenly, and also the earthly remnant he gathers there at the end. So, now notice, people, very important. The bread that I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life. Now, when does he give that? When does he give? He is the bread. That's an idiom, spiritual understanding. The bread from heaven. Not the bread you eat. But when is he going to give? When is he going to give that bread, his flesh, for the life of the cosmos? At Passover, when he gives, when he dies, when he goes to the tree, the cross. And that's when, that's the, when he says, on that night, we will go over that. Be 2 weeks from tonight, we'll go over those verses, Lord willing, and you'll see as he's teaching right up until that faithful night when he has the Passover there with his apostles. Unbelievable, but he's telling, he's leading us right up right now. If you got eyes to see, he's telling you and telling you that he's the bread, not the manna. Now, and he's teaching all the way up till he gives up the bread, gives up his life. See, and he's going to say, this is my new covenant, my last will and testament, that I will shed my blood for the sins of many. And see, and for us, now watch what he says here. The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? Yeshua said to them, verily, verily, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. No, now look what he just said, people. I mean, if you've got eyes to see, that's why Passover is the time of season, the time of life, because the atonement for the sins of many, those that the Father gives, all of his orderly arrangement that Christ died for, right here, he's telling you, unless you eat and drink of this, you have no life in you. And see, the thing about it is, people, that's why Christ said we have to bring forth fruits as a nation, a spiritual nation now, of Gentiles and Jews that are grafted into the commonwealth. We have to bring forth fruit during those seasons. And this is the time of life or season. Of course we have to rehearse Passover, people. It is the door to the kingdom. No man can, you go up through any other door, you cannot get in the sheepfold, he said. This is the door. If you don't partake of this, this is what he's talking about. Now, he's using this in an idiom of actually, literally eating flesh and drinking blood. But that's cannibalism. But now, notice what he says. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath what? Eternal life. Now, when do we start eating and drinking? He's taking us right up to it, people. Passover, the cross. That's why Paul said, I preach nothing but the crucifixion. Christ and him crucified. Because in the crucifixion comes the time of life. It comes the resurrection of the first fruits, and then it's coming around for us at the last day. And then he gathers Israel on that day, Passover. It's a time of season of life. Okay, now people, I will raise him up at the last day. those that eat and drink of blood have eternal life. Now he's going to tell you what it is. He's going to tell you what his flesh is. He's going to tell you what his blood is. For my flesh is meat indeed. The word indeed, people, is truly. It's aletheos. It's a Greek word. It has an alpha, and that gives it an opposite meaning from 227, which means to lie hid. So it means to eat and drink of truth, people. Truth comes 119:142, for my law is truth. It's right here. So we eat and drink of truth, people. That's what he's talking about. Or you don't have any life in you. That's what he said. He eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood, dwelleth in me, and I'm in him. This is a spiritual understanding. As a living, why is that? He that eateth truth and drinketh truth, dwelleth in me and I in him. What does that mean? It means what he told the Samaritan woman at the well, and the Samaritan woman there at Jacob's well in John 4. Today we don't worship with temples made with hands. We worship the Father. He's seeking a people to worship him in spirit and truth, people. So these words are spirit and life. All those that are led by the Spirit reap aeonian life, and he will raise us up at the last day. But this worshiping in spirit and truth is on his divine days. He never changed, done away with them, people. Never done away with his commandments in his divine days. But we can worship him in spirit and truth no matter where we're at. We're scattered all over the globe now. So until the last day, last trump. Now, let's continue here. This is that bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead, that they eat of this bread shall live unto the age. Right here. It just means eternal life. Now, there again, three things he said. If you believe, you eat and drink, I'll give you eternal life. Now, if you believe and you have eternal life, and you're doing his sayings, guess what the promise is? He'll raise you up the last day. So believing in eternal life, you can't stop there. Because that life is in us. But the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead will also raise us from the dead at the last day, last trump. Now, before I close, let's go ahead and let's go now, understanding resurrection, last day, last trump. Let's go to John, the 11th chapter. Okay, we'll go to John 11. Unbelievable, this time of year, people. There's so much the Scripture bears out where we're sitting about this time of year. Now, a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary, and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with her hair, washed the anointment and wiped her feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. So, therefore, his sister said unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom lovest is sick. Now, Christ had left Bethany with the apostles. Now, in John 10, Christ left because the Pharisees, they had picked up stones to stone the Messiah, to kill it. And he said, it's not time. So he left, see. So now we pick it up at 11, and he gets word that Lazarus is sick, but they are a several day walk from now. They're not at Bethany. So, but the reason they left the area was because they were run out. Now let's pick it up here, and let's see. When Yahshua had heard this, his sickness is not unto death, but the glory of God, which the Son of God will be glorified thereby, or through there, the word there. Now, Yahshua loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode, now look, people, he abode two more days, still in the same place where he was. Then after that, said the disciples, let us go into Judea again. Now look what the disciples said to the master. The disciples said to the master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and thou goest there again? You're going back and they wanted to stone you? Yeshua answered, are there not 12 hours here, people? Are there not 12 hours in... Now notice, it's not 12 hours in a day. It's definite an article day. Are there not 12 hours in the day? This means a specific day. It's not plural, people. This is a definite article singular day. Now, if any man walk in the day, he stumbles not because seeth the light of this cosmos. But if any man walk in the night, he stumbleth because there's no light in him. These things said after that, that he saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go that I may wake him out of his sleep, that I may wake him up. Okay, now the word wake out of the sleep, means to awaken, comes from 1853. Now notice the apostles thought that he was just sleeping. Then said the disciples, if he sleep, he shall do well. Now the Greek word here used, it means actually to slumber, but it means to, could be mean to be dead. Howbeit, Jesus spoke of his death, not just slumbering sleep, but they thought that he had spoken of taking of a rest or in sleep, just rested. Then said Yeshua to them, plainly, Lazarus is dead. And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent that you may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Why? Christ said that you will believe. Now, what did he say? There's 12 hours in the day. This is the last day on Enoch's calendar, and Christ is, remember, Lazarus has been dead 2 days, and he said it's 2 days here. He said, Thomas, which is called Didymus, the fellow disciple, let us also go that we may die with him. Thomas is doubting Thomas here. But see, they knew that he was going, the Jews were trying to stone him, so the apostles were saying, oh yeah, we're ready to go die with you. Okay. Well, we know that they're going to deny him when he goes to the cross to die, but they were saying things, well, we'll just go die with him. Now, Christ, I'm the resurrection and life. Then when Yeshua came, he found that laying in the grave 4 days already. So when Christ come back to Bethany, that Lazarus has been dead 4 days. So we can tell by this, the 12-hour day is the vernal equinox, is the spring of the 12-hour last day on Enoch's calendar, which is a sign pointing to the first day of the new year, people. And so right here, if you go back 4 days from the last day, this shows that Lazarus died on the Sabbath. So 4 days later, and this we'll see, it's late in the afternoon when Christ actually raises him. Now, Bethany was nigh Jerusalem about 15 furlongs off, and many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Yeshua was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said, Martha knew Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. Because Christ, now what was Christ doing before he left Bethany? He was healing and so many people. Books can't even write up, they said, as many diseased people as he was healing. So they knew if he had been there, there would have been no trouble for him to heal Lazarus. But that wasn't the reason. That was not why this Christ said he's just asleep, because he was going to wake him out of his sleep through the resurrection. But now I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. This is an unbelievable verse. I don't have time to go into what this is actually referring to, even according to us. But this is unbelievable what Mary, Martha had said to Christ here. That she knows that if Christ asked God, right now he'll give whatever Christ asked her. Now, Yeshua said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Okay. Now, Lazarus is dead. Okay, let's think of this. Lazarus is asleep. He's already buried. He's dead. Now, Christ is saying to Mary, Martha, whatever you ask the Father, I know he's going to give it to you. Now, Christ said, notice that, people. Christ said, your brother shall rise again. Now, this is not talking about just in a few minutes later when Christ literally raised Lazarus from the dead. This is a future, active, indicative voice. So this is not talking about the resurrection just in a few minutes. This means, now watch what Martha says to Lazarus. Watch what Martha says. Okay. Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And guess what, people? This is exactly, in the Greek, is in the future active indicative voice. Both are future active indicative voice. Both of them. So, what Christ said, and then Martha said the same thing. Now, where did Martha learn this teaching? I just showed you. If we follow Christ's teaching, all of the people that he was teaching to that was following him, you don't think they wasn't following him as he taught around Bethany and Jerusalem and in the temple court? We're doing the same thing. We're following him now, 2,000 years later, through the Spirit. The Spirit guides us in all truth. So there again, if Martha knows her brother's going to be raised the last day, why don't we know when we're going to be raised? You think he's part of the body of the Messiah? She's part. Well, they learn it in John 6. How many times did John 6 teach you this? John 6 was taught before this was in John 11. So unbelievable. So right here, Martha confirms, I've already taught that, and I believe that, and I have eternal life, and you've done promised you're going to resurrect this last day. So I know my brother believed in you, and I know you're going to raise him at the last day. But if you'd have been here, he would have never died, see? Okay, let's go a little further here. Yeshua said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though ye were dead, he were dead, yet shall he live. How? Through the resurrection and life, when he's raised. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die, there it is, unto the age, same thing. Believest thou this? She saith unto him, yes, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come unto the world. Yeshua weeps, and when she had said so, she went away, and then here comes Mary. The sister secretly said, the master is come and calleth for thee. As soon as she heard that, she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Yeshua was not yet come unto the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. The Jews then were there with her in the house and comforted her. When they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed unto the grave, and wept there. And when Mary was come there, Yeshua was, and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying to him, same thing. If you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. When Yeshua therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Yeshua wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. And some of them said, if he had been here, he would open the eyes, the one that opened the eyes of the blind, he would have caused that even this man should have not died. All right, Yeshua therefore again groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. If it was a cave, a stone, it was a cave, a stone laid upon it. As you have said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him, said, Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he's been bad. I mean, days, still 4 days, still the same day. Jesus said to him, I said, I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, thou shouldest see the glory of Elohim. Then they took away the stone from the place where his dead was. And look, remember when Martha said to him, I know if you ask at this time, Yahshua lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hearest me at all times. Now this also, this people, at all times here means in all divine times. But because this is a time of lifetime of season, but because of the people which stand, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. And when thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Now, people, this and Lazarus, come forth. So as I close here, unbelievable what the Lord is revealing here as what he actually was fulfilling. Lazarus will be raised at the last day. Just Christ raised him the first time. But remember, he's going to be raised again. So that tells you that's a future voice. So that tells you, for a lot of people that don't know if Lazarus ever died or not, just what Christ say. Your brother's going to rise again. So why was this resurrection the 12-hour day, people, that you might believe? So you will believe and glorify your Father. He's given us the sign 2,000 years ago that the body of the Messiah and all those who have a good report will be raised at the last day, last trump. And that's on Enoch's calendar, and that's the 12-hour day. And that's exactly when Christ raised Lazarus, as the sun commences on the horizon, the 12-hour day. So that's why he said, if you understand the 12-hour day, you have light in you. Christ is in you, and you're in him, because he's revealing these things to us, people. This is so unbelievable. The next study that I will do right before we come into Passover, 2 weeks from tonight, on the meal there, which we will eat and drink of that meal, and those that do that, remember what he said, if you eat and drink of my truth, and you eat and drink, he takes us right up as that celebration, then you have life in you, people. Because we got to do the will of the Father and that's redeem the times. And that's when Christ said, you will bring forth this nation, spiritual nation, will bring forth fruits during their seasons, their divine times, according to the 12-hour day. That's what Christ is teaching, people. It's a 364-day calendar. It days, they don't change. It's the same. It's a set 364-day perfect calendar. Now, I understand there's lots of calendars that people are doing. I'm giving you this information according to Scripture. If you don't believe it, don't believe it. Do what you're doing. But if you follow the Scripture and follow the calendar, when I be lifted up, he said, I will draw all unto myself. Be lifted up means that means divine, and it also means three. So it means divine purpose or three. So when he was lifted up on the third day of the week. See? So all these things fit perfect with this calendar. So there again, I'm giving this, and I believe that the Lord is really pointing this, because it's everything he did, he's teaching us, people, if you've got eyes to see. He's teaching you through the Spirit. If you're communicating him through the Spirit, read the Scripture and see what he's teaching us. The resurrection is at the last day. It is not a rapture at the day of imminency. I teach the harpizo, but that's on the 12-hour day at sunset on Enoch's calendar, the 364th day. That is the rapture at sundown. Okay, now when we come back, we're going to see where Mary washes, anoints Christ's feet with her hair, and we're going to see what day that falls on before he's taken to the cross. May the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, may that spirit witness your spirit. So we've traded these scriptures with one another at this great time of season to understand this great time of season or time of life that is coming in the future for those that believe. In his name, Jesus Christ, amen.